church today as we gather to worship. We're so glad that you are here, and we ask that you would please take the friendship pad, which is located in the center aisle, and let us know your name and some contact information that we can reach you if you're a visitor today. We're glad you're here. I want to give a special shout out to our youngest member of the congregation, Mr. Joel McGraw. We're so happy to have him here today. Please read over the announcements that are in your bulletin. And if you're not already involved in something in the life of the church, you may see some opportunities to join us for service and worship. One way to keep up with this, too, is by the weekly e-news that is sent out on Tuesday. If you don't receive that and would like to, please contact the church office and get signed up for that e-news. It's a good way to stay in touch. We ask also that you please continue to pray for the members of the pastor nominating committee as they spearhead the important work of searching for a new installed pastor for us. We're having a big event. Inez, if you'll come on down, we have a big event coming up this Saturday for all the women who are in the Presbyterian. It's the fall gathering, and Inez is going to give us a little announcement.
Presbyterian women, if you're a woman and you're a Presbyterian, then you're a Presbyterian woman. Whether you have done anything as a group or not, we claim you. Sorry. You're captured. But anyway, we would love for you to come this Saturday. It begins at 10, so you would need to be here a little earlier. I would like for all our women to be here. For several reasons. I want you to know more about the Presbytery. We, as Presbyterian women, we are gathered together in the Presbytery of Mississippi. So this is a meeting, we call them gatherings, of Presbyterian women in the Presbytery of Mississippi. You'll see women here from the whole Presbytery. That means a little above Canton, all the way to the coast. And so there'll be women from all around. Why do I, people say, why do you love Presbyterian women so much? Well, it's connectional. You meet people. You see people from other churches. You see their ideas. You understand the works that they're doing and share ideas, and you can meet a lot of nice people. And who knows, it's connectional, it is a committee sort of large thing. And in times of real trouble, sometimes you need to have a large community. So please, everybody come. Now, get here about 9:30, you have to sign up.
Thank you, Inez. We also welcome another friend of the congregation here this morning to share the Word of God with us and to lead us in worship. Amy Finkelberg. I remembered today after I looked at the bulletin that she is a fellow North Carolinian, so we both grew up in North Carolina. Yeah, in common, and then we're both here in Mississippi now, so that's a connection that I have with Amy, so thank you for coming and sharing with us today. Now let's join our hearts together and prepare to worship God.
Praise the Lord, praise
astray from the ways of the Lord. Let us confess our sins to God with hope of finding love and mercy. God, our wisdom, forgive our foolishness. We desire what we do not need and corrupt our relationships with envy. You urge us to gentleness, but we stir up conflict. Give us your grace that we may harvest righteousness and peace. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our teacher, we pray. Amen.
Believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Be at peace.
We rejoice in God's eternal love and mercy. Thanks be to God.
please join your hearts with mine in prayer. Gracious God, your word is our wisdom. It gives us insight, strength, and courage. Open our hearts and our minds on this day, that we might receive what you want to give. Amen. Our first scripture reading this morning is Mark 9, 30 through 37. Jesus and the disciples went on from there and passed through Galilee. Jesus did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about along the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another who was the greatest. Jesus sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." Then Jesus took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." Our second reading is Psalm 1. Happy are those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or take the path that sinners tread, or sit in the seat of scoffers. But their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law they meditate day and night. They are like trees planted by streams of water, which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves do not wither. In all that they do, they prosper. The wicked are not so, but are like the chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Israel through Moses in the book of Deuteronomy, I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the God, obeying him, and holding fast to him, for that means life to you and length of days. Psalm 1 presents two clear choices, explains the results of those choices, and then, in the tradition of Deuteronomy, leaves it up to us as to which path we take. The first path described is the one that God, who created and loved us, loves us, surely does not want us to take, the way of the wicked. Happy are those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or take the path that sinners tread, or sit in the seat of scoffers. Professor Carol Dempsey explains that three behaviors are being described in Psalm 1, verse 1. Those who are wicked have committed some sort of injustice and have been proven guilty in court. Sinners are those who have violated a specific commandment but have not had to stand trial. Scoffers are those who mock God. These behaviors together constitute the way of wickedness, which, according to scholar J. Clinton McCann, is fundamentally to be self-centered rather than God-centered, to be self-instructed rather than open to God's instruction. Thus, the wicked road is a prideful road. This truth is seen especially in the behavior of those who sit in the seat of the scoffers. The King James Version says that the righteous do not sit in the seat of the scornful. Other translations say the righteous do not sit with the disrespectful or sit in the seat of mockers. Eugene Peterson's colorful translation, The Message, states, "How well God must like you, you don't go to smart mouth college." Scoffing, scorning, being disrespectful, mocking, and acting like a smart mouth all express some level of contempt. The notion that the person on the receiving end of the behavior is somehow beneath the one dishing it out. In today's gospel lesson, the disciples are not necessarily scoffing at or mocking each other, but they are nevertheless following in the way of prideful wickedness, for they are arguing about which one of them is the greatest. And they know what they're doing is wrong, because when Jesus asks them what they have been arguing about, they fall silent. Jesus then shares with the disciples a topsy-turvy, upside-down truth of the gospel. Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all. Humility, not pride, is the hallmark of a true disciple. Humility is also, according to the psalmist, a characteristic of the way of righteousness, because the righteous do not seek after their own way. They did not advance their desires and egos ahead of others' needs or God's teachings. Rather, the righteous are happy because their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on God's law they meditate day and night. The Hebrew word translated law, Torah, literally means instruction. While Torah is accurately used to refer to the first five books of the Hebrew Bible, it also incorporates all of God's instructions in Scripture, including teaching that comes from stories, wisdom sayings, and songs. The righteous are humble enough to have a teachable spirit, and they are blessed because they meditate on God's teaching. The Hebrew word translated as meditate is from the root hagah, which means to muse, to mutter, to recite. Professor Nancy DeClasse Walford states that Haggon conveys the idea of always having the Torah, God's instruction, at the forefront of one's thinking, musing over it, reciting it, and so forth. Not surprisingly, the message conveys an even more vivid and visceral understanding of Haggon. The righteous, it says, will thrill to God's word and chew on Scripture day and night. Muse about, chew upon, recite, and one of my favorite words, ponder, all convey what it means to meditate on God's instruction, God's Torah, because they indicate a thoughtfulness that takes time. But what about specific examples of chewing on the word? Bible study can be a form of meditating on Scripture, as long as we approach our study with a desire to learn from and not master the text. Reading various translations, using a concordance to glimpse what the text means in its original language, learning about the context of a particular passage, delving into various commentaries, discussing the passage with fellow believers. All of these are some ways that study can help us sink our teeth into God's word, God's good word for us. We are human and therefore not capable of offering the final word on God's word, but we can and should engage in active learning with Scripture and with fellow believers. Another way to feed on Scripture is to engage in an ancient practice of the church called Lectio Divina, which means holy reading. Entire books have been written about this spiritual practice, so it is with true humbleness that I offer the following condensed explanation of Lectio Divina from the book Companions in Christ. Lectio Divina involves four essential movements: reading, reflecting, responding, and resting. First, you read a selected passage of Scripture very slowly, perhaps silently and out loud. You try to approach the Scripture with what our Buddhist friends call beginner's mind, as if encountering the words for the first time. Second, you reflect on the text, internalize the words. You wonder why certain words or phrases seem to catch your attention, and ponder what they might mean for you today. Third, you respond to your reading and reflecting by turning to God in prayer. You offer to God your thoughts, feelings, questions, and anything else that comes to mind as a result of your encounter with the text. Finally, you rest your mental activity and trust yourself completely into God's loving care. After a while of simply relaxing in God's presence, you might draw your time at Lectio Divina to close with the Lord's Prayer or simply a moment of grateful silence. I must confess that I tend to be more comfortable encountering Scripture through study rather than through Lectio Divina. Actually, I'm pretty at ease with the first three movements of Lectio Divina. It's the final movement of resting from mental activity and relaxing in God's presence that trips me up a bit. Letting go of mental effort and activity has never been my spiritual strong suit. Nevertheless, I think God blesses my attempts and all of our attempts at meditating on God's Torah, God's instruction for our lives. The psalmist says that those who meditate on God's word are like trees planted by streams of water, which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves do not wither. When we take the time to immerse ourselves in God's teaching, whether through study, Lectio Divina, or some other method, we become strong and supple and rooted. We flourish. And what's more, our flourishing benefits others because we bear fruit. The psalmist also indicates that the righteous who ponder God's instruction will prosper in all that they do. This declaration does not mean that obedience to God's instruction results in material reward. Rather, it should be understood, according to scholar J. Clinton McCann, as an affirmation that persons who trust God have a resource for sustaining their lives under any circumstance. As a tree rooted next to the life-giving water of God's instruction, we can survive life's toughest storms. We may be bowed by fierce winds, but we will not be broken. Unlike those who choose the way of the righteous, those who choose the way of the wicked do not flourish. They are like chaff that the wind drives away. In biblical times, farmers engaged in hands-on threshing, which meant they would scoop up the grain and then let it fall to the ground. The wind would carry away the scraps, the chaff. While the righteous are rooted, the wicked are gone with the wind. Note that in the final verse of Psalm 1, we are told that the way of the wicked will perish. This perishing is not so much a punishment from God as it is the natural outcome of the choice of the wicked. The choice to center their life's journey around the scraps of ego rather than the goodness of God's teaching. Though the psalmist does not actually tell us what to do, it is clear that the way of the righteous is the better path. Why then do we sometimes insist on our own way rather than delighting in God's teaching? Why do we choose the way of shallow desires rather than drinking deeply from God's word? Many reasons exist, but for me, time and effort often come into play. Sometimes I have difficulty prioritizing what's most important. For whatever reason, I tend to obsess over the right way to word an email or how to fold the laundry just so. Certain emails do require an answer, and laundry has got to get done. But I need to work on giving lesser tasks less time so that I can have more time for what's important, like meditating on God's word and then trying to live it. Also, while meditating on scripture can certainly be pleasurable, it's not half as easy as watching the Hallmark romance while curled up on the sofa. Like other activities that are good for us, such as exercise, meditating on God's instructions for our lives requires effort, and the good results are not always immediate. Fortunately for me and for all of us, walking the way of the righteous is not a solo experience. We travel together with faithful companions, and as the psalmist reminds us, the Lord watches over us as we go. Today and every day, two roads diverge before us, and we cannot travel both. Which one will we choose? Amen.
Thank you.
Our hymn is number 840. Will please stand as we sing it together.
Oh,
being good stewards of what God has given to us. Let us then, with gratitude in our hearts, give from what has been given to us by grace.
Bend but not break when the storms of life assail us.
And may we flourish not only for our own sakes, but also for your glory and for the welfare of neighbors near and far. Be near to us in each moment of our living, O God, including this one, as we lift to you the prayer taught to us by our friend and Savior Jesus, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Well, church, it's been a good day. It's about to get even better as we send you out. All right, so why don't you go ahead and stand up. You don't have to sing right away, but turn to page 80 and follow, because each time we do this, it's going to get faster, okay? Just be prepared.
Lift them skyward in joy and praise.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.